Welcome to This Week in Guns, a podcast that covers the latest firearms industry news, information, and buzz, brought to you by the Firearms Radio Network. And I'm your host, Chick Chandler from Gun Guy Radio. And Brownells helps make this show possible. Selection, service, satisfaction. Find it all at Brownells. Please visit thisweekinguns.com/Brownells. And this week we have a smaller panel again, but a great one nonetheless, and a first-timer here, Darrell from Tactical Existence. Hey, Darrell.
Hey, how's it going, everybody?
So, Tactical Existence, what is it?
It's just basically the brainchild of me, I guess. You know, I've been into shooting for about 25 years or so, and I've always wanted to, you know, start my own channel. I actually did a channel with a partner of mine that we still actually have running. It's more of a tech channel, and this was the next step for me. I'm an instructor and armorer, and it's something I always wanted to do. You know, I see a lot of other channels and reviews and of stuff that I disagreed with, so I figured maybe I should put my own perspective out there.
Well, very cool. So, got a YouTube channel. It's youtube.com/
Tactical Existence.
Very cool. And we have Aaron Krieger of the We Like Shooting podcast and We Like Shooting blog. Hey, Aaron.
Hey, it's great to be back on. My goal is to offend as little people as possible this week.
Wait,
maybe.
Wait, you're going to offend little people?
Well, you know what?
Stop it! Stop.
Now you got me going because little people just freak me out. You know, those little cans and stuff. What's up with that?
So,
all right, I'm done.
You're done. So, you guys just released your We Like Shooting challenge for the month of April?
This is April. Yeah, this is April. It's a seven card stud. We got a target that looks like a deck of cards. You shoot it. You try to get the best hand possible. And we got some aces in there, and we got the Firearms Radio Network as our joker, because jokers are wild. So check it out. Yeah, We Like Shooting / shootout.
Very cool. And stay tuned later, Darrell. It looks like you have a giveaway going on. We'll give everyone the details.
Yeah.
Later in the show. So let's get into the top stories of the evening. And start off with an unfortunate incident again at Fort Hood, where a crazed shooter went on a rampage with a .45 caliber handgun. Ivan Lopez, 34, he was an Army specialist, and he went around pretty much indiscriminately shooting people, going from building to building, and was eventually confronted by a woman. She was an M&P, right?
An MP? MP, yeah.
Yeah.
Military police, and she engaged him, and he took his own life, but not before taking lives of three people and wounding 16 others.
Which is usually how it ends.
They usually take their own lives.
Right.
I was talking to my wife about this. My wife's a social worker. And, you know, I thought my wife is not as pro-gun as I am. So I thought she was going to take the tact of, you know, here's another example of people shooting people. But I was really impressed. She's like, she sat down and she said, you know what really bothers me about this? This is... There's rules, there's laws, there's regulations, and people who abide by the laws abide by those rules and regulations. Things like this are going to happen because people, you know, no law is going to prevent this. You know, only security and police force or MPs will prevent this. However, the real issue here is not gun laws. It's not, the real issue here is mental health. And I'm like, that's exactly it. And that's one issue that a lot of people are not addressing. It's a mental health issue that we're looking at here. It's not the fact that, you know, someone's breaking the law, someone's shooting people. There's a problem with people who are not emotionally stable having firearms, and I think that's the big issue here.
Well, that, and I think the other big issue is that the people that we train and, you know, give the responsibility to go over and fight for our country can't be armed on a military base, which to me is absolutely insane.
Well, that's the rule anyhow. They're not supposed to be.
Yeah. So, but if that were different, I don't think either one of these should be.
I see what you're saying. You're saying that they should be armed. They should have the ability to protect themselves.
Yeah. I mean, if we're going to spend, you know, the time to train these people to go fight for our country, you know, in the worst places on earth, but we don't feel that they're responsible enough to carry a weapon on base, it kind of doesn't make sense to me.
That is kind of an odd thing. What do you think, Jake?
Yeah, I do think that. We had a discussion similar to this a while back, and I think Peter Palma was on the show. He's a former Marine sniper, and I thought he would kind of take that approach as well, but I think he kind of played devil's advocate and said, you know, he could see why it might not be a good idea for, you know, to have soldiers have their weapons all the time on base, but I don't know.
Well, when I was in Germany, I was at the where I was at in Gießen was where they kept all the weapons, you know, but the armory, but the munitions dump was like 17 kilometers down the road. You know, they never kept them together. So I understand you don't want to have that thing, but look, I mean, let's look at what happened over in the Ukraine. A lot of those soldiers weren't armed when the Russian forces came and took their base. You know, I'm sure there might have been more of a, they might have put up a fight if they had that opportunity. Now, that being said, U.S. troops, like Darrell's saying, if they were armed, there wouldn't be, I'm pretty sure there probably wouldn't be as many casualties as there were.
Right. Well, and, you know, if...
I mean, one of the casualties was a major who had done two tours in Iraq. I mean, I'm sure he's battle-tested. I'm sure he would understand what to do in case of a situation where he's being fired upon.
Or would it have happened, period.
Yeah, it's hard. I mean, it's hard to say what wouldn't have happened, you know, in a different scenario. But, you know, it's essentially a gun-free zone, which drives me a little crazy because if, you know, some of those soldiers have a carry permit of some kind, I would think they would be at least allowed to do that, but they're not even allowed to conceal carry on base unless I did see in one article that they could go through a process to be allowed to, but it wasn't real clear what that was.
Yeah, I think the real issue though again is mental health. And if you look at like the Giffords, you know, I want to say Kathy Lee, but that's not her name.
Gabriel.
Yeah, she's been pushing for, you know, gun legislation. And what she really should be pushing for is mental health, you know, legislation, because it wasn't a sane person who shot her. You know, it wasn't, and the fact that the laws on the books already pretty much were supposed to there are set there to protect her, let's enforce the laws that we have, not increase the laws that are out there, and let's help treat people who have issues.
Right, and I'm not sure I'm necessarily for, you know, more mental health laws either. I'm not sure that laws are the answer here. Absolutely, it's a mental health issue. But like this guy, he was not diagnosed for any severe, you know, mental ailments. He was not PTSD or anything like that. He was in Iraq for a little bit, but he never saw combat. And, you know, some people you just don't know. I mean, even if this guy was going to a psychiatrist, you know, if he's not telling the psychiatrist everything, then, I mean, how do we know?
Yeah.
Right.
We never know.
Well, and then there's the flip side of that, too, is, You know, you don't necessarily have to be crazy to go crazy. You know, it's like the old the thing with the dog, where people say it's not the dog, it's how you bring it up. Well, you know, that's a total another issue. But I mean, from time to time, animals like people just snap. I mean, maybe that's a case of this happening here. But the thing is would not having a firearm prevented this guy from going crazy? Of course not. And if you want to do a crime, if you want to commit mass murder, you're going to do it. But having a firearm's not going to, you know, it's not going to prevent it if there is no firearm for him to get.
Well, and
we know criminals don't follow those laws anyway.
Well, exactly. And there's, you know, there's a big segment of our population that doesn't want to admit that there's evil in this world, that there's evil, bad people. There's just people just do terrible things, unthinkable things. They just don't want to admit to that. They want to make excuses. They want to say, you know, we teach them the right things when they're growing up. We ban all the guns. We, you know, do everything. It would be a perfect, happy little world. You know, nothing bad will ever happen. It'd be peace, joy, and love, right?
Right.
And that's just not the case. We live in a broken world. There's evil in the world, and unfortunately, terrible things like this happen because of that. But you know, I think this kind of highlights how we as good people need to be prepared, and by whether, you know, where we live or where we work, you know, that can put us at risk by, you know, being in a gun-free zone and our practically gun-free states, like Illinois up to recently. It's just, you know, we have to take our personal protection. You know, that's our thing. You know, that's our number one responsibility is for us and our family. And if we can't have the means, the tools to at our disposal when the time comes, I mean, what do we do?
Yeah, all you have to do is watch the news every night, and you'll know there's evil in the world. You know, I seen one of those little memes on Facebook, and it was basically like, you know, if outlawing guns, you know, makes the world a safer place, or America, or whatever you're talking about at that moment, then, you know, it said, why don't they outlaw meth, or why don't they outlaw cocaine, or, you know what I mean, why don't they just outlaw murder, and then, you know, won't ever be murdered. Right. I mean, it's the most ridiculous thing in the world for me to hear someone say, well, if we change this to where, you know, law-abiding citizens can't have it, then that'll put a stop to it. Well, if that's the case, that's just the thing. Let's outlaw murder. Let's outlaw rape. Let's outlaw all these drugs that we don't want, and problem solved, right?
Define what you don't want, because there's, you know, something that I want. Just saying. Anyhow, yeah, totally. It's ridiculous. And again, I'm gonna hammer the point. It's a mental health issue. Sane people, normal people, people like you and I, well, at least me, don't go around shooting people. You know.
Yeah, without, obviously had problems, yeah.
Yeah. And you know, same with the Navy Yard shooter. There were signs, people saw it, no one did anything.
Now, they did talk to this guy, though. I mean, he did have an evaluation, but he wasn't, you know, it's like you say, how do you know what he's going to tell a therapist?
Yeah, you never know what, you really never know what's inside someone's head.
That's it.
Brains are in there. I've seen it.
All right. Well, we'll move on to the next topic, but our thoughts and prayers are definitely with the families of the victims.
Yeah, poor Fort Hood. Absolutely. What's up with that?
Yeah, I mean, it's our servicemen, and women. What a terrible place. I mean, any place is terrible for this to happen. But
you know, but I just have one more thing on this. Is, you know, Fort Hood had a shooting recent, or not recently, but in the past there, I think it was, when was that, 2009?
Sounds about right.
Yeah, and you think they would have put a whole new set of, you know, plan in place for this kind of thing to happen.
Supposedly they had.
Yeah.
And supposedly they had, and that's the thing is, you know, is it the problem of guns, or is it the problem that let's fix the issue that allowed this to happen? And like I say, I think that, to me, that could have been as easy as having more guns on base. Maybe right. Not every soldier should be able to carry their weapon, but, you know, a lot more of them should be able to.
Sure. Yeah, maybe doing something where, you know, you get to a certain rank. And
yeah, at least the officers and the NCO.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, if you're going to run in and shoot people, where are you going to go? Someplace where you know someone doesn't have a gun.
Right. Of course. So, the next story, we are back to the ATF. No, that's, I skipped. So, the NSSF blog, they released this week that the firearms industry, they kind of outlined the economic impact that the firearms industry has had on the economy in the last 5 years, and it's been quite the impact. So, from 2008 to 2013, the firearms and ammunition industry has increased from a $19.1 billion industry to $37.7 billion. That's pretty impressive for 5 years.
Yeah, someone should give, Obama an award for that.
Right. Well, I was wondering, there's a couple things that are going on. You have two wars going on, so your ammo expenditures are going to go up, because you got to supply your troops, train your troops. And we have, I think it was last year, the National Guard has the largest live fire simulation ever. That costs a lot of ammo. Now, the post office is getting guns and ammunition. That's kind of sucking up some ammo there. There was that buying scare after Newtown, where everyone bought an AR, and the prices got jacked up there. I mean, I can see where the profits are coming in. I'm not looking at it as a year to year. I'm just, for that time frame, I can see why they've made a lot of money. I mean, what we really need to look at as a 10-year cycle to see where the numbers lie. Because see if it's inflated because of the issues with Newtown, with the issues with fear buying, with the issues with a Democratic president who keeps putting in people in place who are pretty anti-firearms. And of course, when these two wars wind down enough where we have supplies and troops and firearms, because those manufacturers are also selling those firearms, they're making money that way too. That's another profit.
Yeah. But, this has been going on since, as far as war fighting, it's been going on forever nearly, but I mean, since 2001, this is definitely, in my eyes, a directly caused by the current administration. I mean, there's no doubt about it. Weapons dried up for quite a while there during the scare, and that was in direct relation to Sandy Hook and the whole scare of another gun ban like we had back in 93. The war thing, that's been going on forever and ever. But to me, this is an indefinite relation to that. I mean, 93, you didn't see this kind of jump.
Yeah, well, what's nice, too, is the amount of people who are also becoming more gun, getting into the sporting gun world.
Absolutely.
The female population's exploding, not literally, hopefully. Yeah.
I think it totally backfired on them. What it did, from what I've seen, it's caused a lot more interest in firearms. It's caused a lot of people that, just me personally, that I never thought would be into firearms, now are like, hey, can we go out shooting or whatever? And, something that people, I think, need to really do is don't pass up those opportunities. If you have the opportunity to take someone that is a non-shooter or, someone that has not been a gun enthusiast at all in the past, and you have an opportunity to introduce them the right way to firearms, make sure you seize that opportunity.
Yeah, absolutely. And another thing that, also is that jobs have rose quite a bit. They've risen from 166,000 to 245,000 in that time period as well. So that's pretty cool. And it also says that the average income for these jobs averages $47,000 a year plus benefits. So that's
yeah. Well, you know, plus they're running three shifts, you know, around the clock to build ammo. I mean, that's huge right there, and they're still not keeping up.
And that's another funny thing about the whole. I mean, I guess we shouldn't get started on too political as far as this current administration, but to me, that's another idiotic attempt. Is you're taking one of the biggest booming industries in the country right now, and you're trying to, you know, belittle it and basically dismantle it any way you can.
Right.
And with the economy that we've been in, and, you know, let's call this a recession, depression, whatever you want to call it. This has been going on for, you know, over 10 years with our economy, our housing. I mean, look where you're at there, Aaron, in Detroit. I mean, not to be negative, but I'm from there too.
No. Yeah, Detroit sucks.
Yeah, I mean, just look what's happened there in the last 10 years alone. And then it's a prime example to what, you know, if you want to have a look at a democratic future and how it would work in America, have a look at Detroit.
Oh, it's a paradise in Detroit. Yeah. Right?
I took my kids to a Tigers game yesterday, and I'm driving down Grand River, one of the main avenues into Detroit, and there's houses collapse, garbage everywhere, and my kid's like, what happened here? And I'm like, this is what happens when society just stops caring. And it was just, you know, I was actually, you know, and I couldn't bring a firearm with me because I didn't want to leave it in my car down in Detroit, and I couldn't bring it into the baseball game with me. So I'm like, oh, this is kind of, you know, I felt intimidated. I felt slightly unnerved just, you know, being in Detroit. It's nasty down there.
Well, you know, the good news is that Detroit has hope again. I hear RoboCop's back.
I actually saw that. It really bothered me, that movie. Did you see the movie RoboCop?
No.
There's a guy. I'm not. All right,
spoiler alert.
Yeah, spoiler. If you haven't seen it yet and you're planning on seeing it,
pause yourself.
Exactly. There's a guy in there who's who's supposed to be a weapons expert, and he's holding a rifle, and he's like, yeah, this clip holds 30 rounds. I'm like, are you serious?
Well, it could have been one of those 30 round magazine clips from the ghost gun.
Right. Took me a minute. Yeah, I guess. No, I was just so like frustrated. I'm like, the whole movie was ruined for me after that. It was like in the first 5 minutes. I'm like, I'm done.
Yeah, movies kill me sometimes. I mean, I don't know how many times I've seen. I don't remember what movie it was, but it was years ago. Me and a buddy of mine were watching this movie, and this guy comes out, and he's got these two full-auto pistols, and they're like 9mm. And he's blasting away, and there's five to six shells just ejecting out of both guns. We just look at each other and laugh, you know? I mean, I'm available.
Right.
Hollywood, I'm available. Actually, I'm not. Hollywood's mostly anti-gun, so...
I don't know, Brad Pitt, Angelina Jolie, they're huge gun supporters.
Hey, there's two.
Right, and they're like Hollywood royalty.
So ATF issues letter about multiple uploads for their new e-forms. Apparently, gun shops have been crashing the new ATF e-form system. And
I'm sorry, are you saying a government website's not working?
I know, shocking. I must be hosting on the same...
It's never happened.
There is the Obamacare sites, right?
That's it.
It's pretty funny, though, because the ATF released this notice, urgent notice to all registered ATF eForms user, and, you know, it says you cannot batch them, you cannot upload multiple ones at a time because it will basically crash a system because of a memory issue. And like, basically they're saying, like, yeah, we have no idea how to program our website, so please be careful with it. You might break it.
Yeah, and if you send too many at once, they may revoke your privilege to even be able to send any at all. I mean, come on. You're the ones who are retarded.
Right. Get a programmer that knows what the heck they're doing, right?
Right. Don't fault the end user for your inability to set something up correctly.
Yeah, look who we're talking about, though.
Right.
I mean, do they want to fix the problem? You know, that's the real issue. But, yeah, that's ridiculousness.
Yeah, it's just points out, you know, more how inept our federal government is. It's what happens when it gets to this level of bureaucracy.
Oh, I'm sure. You know, it's probably like 15 people, 15 layers of approval to get, you know, to get one page done on this thing.
Right.
That's the funny thing.
Yes. And they probably have to
have like 15 or have 20 meetings just to discuss what they're going to do. And, you know, everyone walks out going, well, I don't know what we're going to do. I thought you were going to do that.
Yeah. No, we're talking about that at the next meeting.
Exactly. Months from now.
Well, look, we all have websites. The government is, you can trust the government. They're going to take care of you, right? That's what they tell you.
Yeah, well, look, I felt like the government was running my website today.
Well, I've got my 13-year-old nephew built my website. Come on, the government's got to have somebody that can get a website working.
Right.
Yeah,
well, I think they had some 13-year-olds build their website.
Seriously. I mean, come on. You know, and if you need more memory, buy more servers. You're the government. You have money. Obviously, I pay it every year.
Right, you know. They're still upgrading their 286s.
Right. What do you mean this calculator can't take the internet?
My nephew did not build my website, by the way.
Oh, okay, sure. You can. I'm gonna feel bad for your nephew now because he's all proud. He's like, my uncle's talking about me. Now he's all like, damn it.
His dad worked for the government, so they don't see the show.
So Ruger issues a recall for the SR-556 VT, the AR-15 rifle. So this is the varmint version of the SR-556 by Ruger, and they're recalling it because quote they had some poorly sourced, I guess, disconnectors that were improperly heat treated by a vendor. And the disconnector can wear prematurely, which turns the rifle into a delayed fired feature.
We can
call this a feature, right?
Or a double fire.
Yeah, well, right? It goes off when you pull the trigger. It goes off when you release the trigger.
That's awesome.
It's like, isn't that what TACCON is? It's like a new TACCON?
Right. Ruger's. That's what they should have labeled it.
They should have patented it.
TACCON on it. Or RugCon.
RugCon, there you go. Well, you know,
go ahead.
It's just like, you know, Ruger, it's a good name, but when you start, you know, asking your suppliers to be the lowest bidder, that's where you're going to get crap quality stuff. You know, spend the money. People are going to buy your name. People are going to buy your gear. Spend the money. Get a good company to do your stuff that actually quality control checks their stuff that they put out to you. Because now it's going to cost you even more money, you know, to get all these guns in, have your Smiths refit them, and then mail them all back out.
Well, that, or did the company that they did outsource those to, you know, was that company, you know, maybe they didn't necessarily. I have a 5.56, and I absolutely love that gun.
You have a Ruger?
Yeah, I've had no issues with it whatsoever. I love the thing. As a matter of fact, I had a buddy borrow it and put the piston in backwards when he took it apart. Brought it back to me, and I fired the gun like that, put it back in, it still runs fine. But, I mean, maybe it was just the company that they did outsource it to.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, but they are a company with that's known for quality. They should, you know, you're willing to pay that extra dollar.
I'll play devil's advocate, too.
You do that.
You know, a part like this, you know, it has to do with the heat treating. That's not... I wouldn't think that's necessarily an easy thing to test. Maybe it is, but you know, if Ruger's sourcing this, they you know maybe worked with this company before, and they're like, we need this part to this specification, heat treated to this specification, and they get them in, and they you know visually they probably look fine and everything, and maybe even the first test samples they got were fine, but then something down the line fell off the tracks, and it may have had nothing to do with Ruger. Ruger will take care of you customer service wise, they usually, from what I've heard, send you an extra magazine or something.
Oh, yay.
Have a recall. Yeah.
Excellent customer service from Ruger. And well, I agree with you 100%. I wouldn't bash Ruger over this incident because it could be something totally unrelated to them. And like you, I kind of agree that part. You know, they're probably not going to get those in and test for heat treating. Hey.
Well, let me ask you then, how'd they find out? I mean, they said, and according to their statement, they said, although no incidents have been reported from the field, this is an important safety issue that we are therefore recalling the rifles. So someone must have noticed along the way, if nothing ever happened out in the field, if no person shooting this firearm had an issue, how do they know about this issue in the first place?
Because Ruger probably Ruger tests their own weapons, and those guys actually own the weapons. So maybe right. It happened to one of those people, or maybe it happened during a test.
Yeah, it could have been an employee that competitively shoots with us or something, or
something. Just during a routine test, because most of their guns are fired. Maybe it, something happened then. The wear thing worries me. Is it wear or are they breaking? You know, I mean, it says wear, but I mean, you're talking some really quick wear, especially with a varmint rifle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, you're not going out with a varmint usually, and in 30 rounders. So, I would assume that it happened probably through an independent testing, or it happened, from Ruger testing would be my guess. But who really knows, But yeah, I wouldn't down Ruger for that one situation. You know, it's not like they're Remington right now.
So, if you have a Ruger SR556 VT, so it's only this varmint VT model, you can contact their Newport customer service. They're in the show notes. Here's an article with the phone number. I'm sure you can email them as well. So British sniper kills 6 Taliban soldiers with 1 bullet. That's right.
So 1.
This when I saw this headline, it made me think of the scene from Indiana Jones. Where
I was just going to say that.
I thought the same thing.
Yeah, so, that's awesome.
So, this British sniper, he was in, this happened in Afghanistan. Actually happened, I think, back in December, but they're just now releasing the information. But the 20-year-old marksman, he shot at a Taliban soldier 930 yards away. And he was carrying a heavy machine gun, too, if I remember right.
The Taliban person?
The Taliban person, right. So the sniper shot him, and he blew up like Tannerite, I guess.
That is awesome.
And he had some buddies around him, so it took out 6 of them with 1 bullet. Did he, get a level-up thing come up in the scope?
I'm assuming.
He got an achievement award for that, for sure.
Right.
I'm assuming that Tannerite are going to have new target systems, new packaging depicting this situation. I can see it.
You know what, though? The funny thing is it was just a lucky shot, because he's like, I just shot, and I just happened to hit the thing,
Oh, yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah.
Because it was from the trigger switch. Yeah.
Or maybe he fell. Did he blow up right away, or did he fall on the trigger switch?
I think a shot when he hit. No, he hit the trigger switch of the suicide bomber.
He did hit it.
Suicide, yeah.
That's awesome.
From 930 yards away, which is even better.
You know, I'd have had to play that off. I mean, especially at 20. I mean, when I was at 20, I could do no wrong. You know, I knew it all. So, I mean, if that would have been me, I would have just looked and like, yeah, I seen that switch. I had to go for the switch. But yeah,
that's a great shot. I mean,
yeah, it is. Whether it was accidental or not.
Yeah. That's a fantastic shot. I wish more things like that would happen. Reminds me that I was on the show last time. We were talking about the bomb maker who was showing his students how to make a bomb with a live bomb and blew them all up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Stuff like that it's like karma instantly.
Yeah. I'm not
not losing sleep over it.
Yeah, that's exactly it. I mean, You know, they're out to get us. I mean, that bomb that he blew up, that blew up those six people, who knew how many people that bomb could have taken out, how many soldiers.
Right, and he was probably not even going after soldiers with that bomb. He was probably going after civilians. So, yeah, good. It's a win-win for the good guys, for sure.
I say good on you.
So, NSSF and SAAMI file suit against California microstamping law. This microstamping law passed several years ago. I think it was in 2007. It went into effect on May 17th of 2013 last year, where every handgun that from that point on that is added to the California handgun list, which is a list of handguns that are safe that you can buy, they have to have micro stamping on each shell, each cartridge. Each spent cartridge has to have a marking that is matched to two other markings on the actual firearm. So they do this by putting a stamp on, cut in the metal of the firing pin. So when it hits the primer, it embeds those markings. Problem is, that's patented technology, and also that technology is not proven and it is unreliable. And from my understanding, this law even has written in it that this technology has to be freely available. It can't be something that has a patent on it. But yet they're enforcing this, and so the NSSF and SAAMI are filing suit. I think they have a pretty good chance on this, even taking into account that's California. But it would be very good to get this stupid law off the books. What do you guys think?
I think it's as dumb as the new smart gun. It should have never been implemented. That's, one guy, which is the company, came up with the idea. There's really no one out there that can do it, especially in masses. And, I mean, it makes no sense. Number one, if you're a criminal, once again, you can alter the firing pin. Or change the firing pin.
Anyone can just swap out a firing pin, you know.
And then the NRA and everyone should get involved in suit. I mean, what we need to do is start knocking down the doors of these ignorant laws. And to me, I think the right thing's going on. They need to file suit because all the stuff that's going on, I think that we allow it. And that's something we need to stop. I mean, more people need to get involved, basically. I mean, there's a lot of sitting around talking about it, but, it's time to write your elected officials, write the NRA, get them more involved. But, yeah, I think the right thing's going on. I think it'll be successful because it just makes no sense whatsoever.
Well, I wonder if Yee had anything to do with this.
Yeah, no kidding.
It's interesting that SAAMI is filing suit in part of this. Because SAAMI is the organization that regulates the pressures that ammo manufacturers are allowed to load their ammo to.
Right.
That's very interesting that they're part. I mean, it makes sense. I just would have never thought of them throwing their hat into this ring.
Why they're probably getting a lot of pressure from ammo manufacturers.
Didn't like Cal Guns and another organization already have arguments against this too? Mm-hmm. So I mean, people are fighting it. It's nice to see some more names putting their names in the hat, in the ring, whatever the analogy is for that.
Yeah, since it was first brought up.
Yeah, I think this is the first actual lawsuit though against it. So, I'm hopeful, so we'll just have to see how that plays out. So there's an ammo case processor in Montana now that was raided. So this is a company called U.S. Brass, and they from what I understand, they get once-fired brass, and they clean it, and they sell it. I'm not even sure that they actually manufacture.
No, they just clean it. Yeah, they just clean it and resell it.
And so the EPA, criminal division of the EPA, raided the plant in Bozeman, Montana, and because they're saying that there's an occupational health safety issue here. They're saying workers were overexposed to lead and failed to provide basic safeguards. They failed to provide basic safeguards to reduce lead exposure, including breathing protection and protective clothing.
Huh. Well, you know, I think that the big deal here was, I mean, okay, first of all, if that's true, then they should be fined for exposing their workers to an unsafe place. However, I think the real issue of the story was it wasn't just, you know, the EPA who kicked down the door. It was the FBI showed up, you know, tactical squad, you know, their tactical division showed up with guns. It wasn't just, you know, hey, here's a summons, let's see your paperwork, here's a, you know, we're going to do a walkthrough and take a look at everything and check your lead levels. No, it was their paramilitary style unit coming into the building and being like, you know, shut it down, we're taking over here and looking at this place. So I think that was the biggest issue of it all.
Yeah, that's the only way they do business. I mean, everything they do, that's how they do it. Whether it's a routine sort of thing, even if they know they're coming, they come that way. It's a show of power. But yeah, I mean,
when else do they get to play with their toys?
That's exactly right, and that's exactly it. But yeah, on this one, I don't know. I don't really know the facts from what I've read there. Maybe they are, putting these people's health at risk. I don't know. So, but if they are, then yeah, I don't think going in with the with M16s and MP5s is the way to handle it. You know, kind of like Aaron, I think they should go in and did their testing, shut the place down if needed to, find them until they are up to code or whatever. But yeah, there's no reason. I mean, come on, these people clean brass. It's not like they're in there with, you know, heavy machine guns.
So do you think this was a disgruntled employee that caused all this?
Possibly, yeah. I mean,
I bet it was a woman, too, on top of it. Yeah, no, I'm serious, man. Man, women, they're like,
ladies, or lemon pledge.
Hell have no fury, you know.
Ladies, send your complaints to www.hairdresser.com.
My name is Jake Challen.
No.
But yeah, I mean, yeah, possibly. I mean, you know, somebody may have lost their job, and who knows?
So Japan lifts a 50-year-old ban on weapons exports.
So I wonder when they're going to start sending us all those tentacles that we see in those videos that they make. Yeah, you guys know what I'm talking about.
So what what kind of gun are you going to put a pre-order in from Japan? Do they even make anymore? I don't even know. But,
yeah, seriously, like some sort of AK variant or a. Every time I saw a movie with a Japanese rifle and it had a bayonet on the end of it, so I don't know.
Oh yeah, I'm sure they make their own version of the AR or not the AR but the AK and all that. I mean, who knows? That's the thing is, I mean, I'm sure there's somebody out there that knows, but I don't even know what.
I mean,
makes that I would want.
I mean, they make great TVs, right?
I'd like to have a nice samurai sword.
Yeah, does Mitsubishi, do they make guns? You know, because
they made the planes for a while, so.
The Koreans, at Daewoo, they make guns, right?
And Daewoo makes everything.
Yeah, they do.
I mean, you can go in, like, if there were a Daewoo dealer, you go and get your car, your fridge, your TV, your gun, you're good to go.
Right. I need a house. Well, Honda used to make, like, musical equipment, right? They still do.
Yeah, same with Yamaha.
Yeah. So there you go. I mean, I remember a while ago looking at some old guns that aren't in service anymore, that they were, World War II surplus, taken as spoils kind of thing. And there were some really interesting Japanese firearms that had really interesting ways of loading and positioning their ammo in there. And I wonder if those, and they still use those kind of things. I don't know. I'm not up on my you know, the only thing I know about is the tentacles.
There could be something cool. I mean, who knows? This could be a positive. Just
microwaves. Like microwave lasers that you see fighting Godzilla all the time.
Who knows what's out? But something to keep an eye on because, you know, something cool can come from that.
Yeah.
I don't keep up on my Japanese firearm culture, so.
Well, I mean, just because they lift the ban, though, then they have to get the an importer here in the States to bring it in.
Right.
And that's, you know, a whole nother can of worms.
Yeah.
So, because I know, you know, like certain firearms are restricted.
Well, and then they have to want to do it.
Just yeah.
Because the ban was lifted doesn't mean that, you know, they're looking to send anything over here.
Yeah, and from what I read, it was basically they just want to arm their Asian counterparts in, you know, the Asian Pacific Rim kind of thing.
Right.
Okay, so I'm doing some research here, and there's a company called Myroku.
They make vacuums.
It sounds like it.
Myroku does? Well, they it says here that they used to make 38 Smith & Wesson lines of revolvers, and they also made stuff for big manufacturers like Browning and Winchester, some of their shotguns. And then someone else here says that Weatherby is made by Japan.
Well, of course, they're a manufacturing country. You know, that's kind of, right. You know, like China or and everything else. You know, we, unfortunately, we got rid of U.S. manufacturing basically because we gave it all up to cheaper production out of country. And now, you know, we suffer for that in a lot of different instances. So, yeah, they're a manufacturing company, so, yeah, I'm sure they make stuff. That's what I'm saying. There could be something great over there that we don't know about. They're a manufacturing company. Could be some great stuff.
Yeah, they probably have a gun that shoots knives, right?
They have a knife that shoots guns.
Well, who wants to know that there's an exact copy of all kinds of stuff that we have over there.
right. Yeah, maybe get a budget Desert Eagle or something.
Yeah, get a Maruku Eagle.
Right.
I don't know that I want to shoot a Maruku Eagle or a Desert Eagle in 50A&E, but.
Well, speaking of a little bit off brands, Diamondback Firearms introduces the new DBFS line, or nine, not line, nine pistols. So. Diamondback Firearms are based in Miami, Florida, I believe, and they came about just a few years ago. They're a fairly young company. They were founded in 2009. They're based in Cocoa, Florida. And I believe they're a subsidiary of Taurus, and now they're coming out with a full-size polymer pistol that looks... what do you guys think this looks like?
Check it out. I looked at it earlier, and this is the thing. They are in Cocoa with Caltech.
You think this looks like a Caltech?
I think it looks like Glock and the PMR-30 had a baby. And I don't think it's bad. I think it's a cool-looking gun, to be honest with you.
See, I thought it looked like a Desert Eagle had sex and with a high point and then had an abortion, and that's what we're looking at here.
No, I think it does. I think it kind of resembles a Glock and a PMR-30. But, I mean, I don't think it's that bad.
So it's got a pretty low profile, you know, it's got a pretty low bore axis.
Right. Yeah.
And it's got the Glock-style takedown stupid thingy. but it has kind of a little bit of a Glock-style trigger safety and a Glock-style magazine release. It does have very...
It's a Glock tech. I mean...
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm looking at this thing, and it's not an ED, you know, it's not EDC because it looks like it's double stack. You got, what is it, 15 rounds in there?
Why is that not an EDC?
It looks like it probably is super heavy.
It does? Yeah. Looks like a polymer framed. It looks like a Glock. It's a polymer framed steel Glock gun.
You know what it looks like? It looks like someone took a Dremel to a Glock and went to town. Because it's really thin. It looks like a Glock. You know, went and threw up in the bathroom and came out and.
Mm-hmm. So it looks like an aborted gun. Like someone was making a gun and they were like, oh,
no, it's really not terrible looking. I'm with,
I don't think so either.
Yeah, I'm with Darrell here, right? I think the slide looks really cool. And,
I do too.
No, the bottom end isn't too bad either.
Look, a lot of people pay, they take their Glocks and pay for it to look like that. They pay for it to have those relief cuts.
Right.
Lighten up the slide. You know, and I don't know if you guys have shot any of the Diamondback, you know, mini guns, little subcompacts, but they're not bad guns. I've actually shot them a few times.
It's got a huge, like a 1911 beaver tail on it.
Yeah, but a lot of people are going to that too. Like Glock, for instance, now has those, the M&P. This kind of resembles, like, to me, I mean, of course, from the trigger guard up, this looks like a Glock. The reason I say the PMR-30 is because of the rail on the bottom. It looks sort of like the PMR-30. But yep. If you look at the grip, it kind of looks like a Smith & Wesson M&P.
So, it looks like you're looking at a girl and she's really skinny on top, but then she's got like a huge ass.
But I like that.
I mean, it's disproportional. It looks uncomfortable. I mean, I guess I'm going to have to shoot it. I'm dogging it out right now, but yeah, if I don't think I have a chance to shoot it.
I don't think it looks unproportional at all. Now, it may be the angle of that picture. It does kind of look stretched.
Yeah.
You know, I've actually Google searched the images of him, and I'm looking at all the pictures they have out there.
It looks like about, I mean, from this picture here, it looks like about the size of a Glock 22.
So it has an MSRP of 483, so we'll probably see it in the low 400s retail. Yeah. Which is, you know, that's pretty decent.
Yeah, we'll probably see in the streets of Detroit for 200 and maybe 150.
About the price of an R-51, a Remington R-51. And if it fires, I mean, you're on to something.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not convinced. It's not pretty. It's not like my gun. My gun's pretty. This one's not.
Well, all I can say is stay tuned because I will get one to test.
All right.
You heard it here first, folks.
Heard it here first. So, AR Maglock, no bullet button required.
I love this.
There's this new workaround for the California and I guess now New York laws now require something like this as well. But it's a little... I don't know what you would call it. It's not a bullet button. It's they call it a mag lock. So it's a piece of steel you slide into your you mount in your magazine where your magazine release would go, and it allows you to pull the rear takedown pin, pop the rifle apart a little bit, and then push on this piece of steel, and it freeze your magazine. So it actually seems like it's quicker than maybe a bullet button.
Yeah, it's American ingenuity. With everything that they throw at us, that and it's just these, at least currently, it's these New York, it's California, and everything they come up with, thank goodness there's a way around. Like now the New York legal ARs. I mean, yeah, they're ugly, but hey, people there can have them now. So I think it's great. It's, you know, it defeats an unfair law.
Yeah, the ingenuity of the American people is pretty awesome when it comes to this.
And quick.
You know, you ban these scary cosmetic features and we'll just make them look scarier.
It is pretty cool how it works, though. I mean, you pull that takedown pin in the rear, and then you're able to release that mag. But while it's in there, there's no way to release that. So, you know, it does what it was intended to do. And yeah, it's definitely quicker than a bullet button. So. But I think it's pretty cool.
Yeah, I just think the whole process is dumb.
Well, it is.
Stupid law.
Yeah. I mean,
if you got to take your gun apart every time you want to change your magazine.
That's it.
I mean, come on. That's ridiculous.
The great thing about that was, to me, though, is in, you know, reading and watching it, is, of course, there is no such thing as a quick reload with this, but it's a lot quicker than removing a bullet button.
Yeah, it's just, you know, like, how are you going to go out and enjoy shooting if you got to take your gun apart every... What, don't they have, like, a magazine capacity limit out there, too?
Yeah, they don't want you to enjoy shooting. That's the whole get around. And that's the truth. They want to make it so difficult for us that we don't want to do it anymore. And that's why I think these get arounds are so so important. Like, you know, I feel so so sorry for the people that have to have those New York legal ARs because, oh man, they are god awful ugly. But I think it's fantastic that they're able to have them. And this is kind of the same thing on the same lines to me.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So Track and Point is now accepting bitcoins for firearm sales. So, Aaron, I hope you've been mining your bitcoins, saving them up.
I'm so flush in bitcoins right now, it's ridiculous. No, but what about what just happened with bitcoins? Weren't there, like, didn't one of the bitcoin exchanges just collapse recently?
Well, someone stole a bunch of them, right?
Like 800,000 bitcoins.
Yeah.
You know, that's the problem with digital currency. Is it digital? I mean, is it an actual... I've never seen a bitcoin. Is it an actual coin?
No, it's completely digital. So.
Right. Yeah, and I'm glad I did this because, you know, now I don't have to spend the cash. I can just go ahead and use my bitcoin and get this.
Right. Yeah, because I'm sitting on... Well, maybe the person who has 800,000 bitcoins they found can buy two Track Point rifles.
This is all a ruse to get them to use those bitcoins that they stole.
Well, that was supposed to be one of the big benefits of Bitcoin. It was so secure that it wasn't supposed to, you know, it was like the Titanic. It's the unstealable currency, and then someone steals it.
Right. Well, you know, the problem with Track Point is, first of all, it's a great concept. It's pretty neat. The problem with it is it's just so expensive. I guess they have to try any avenue whatsoever for people to buy it, you know.
Yeah, but look. I'll play the devil advocate on this. To their defense, you know, everything's like that, you know. At one time, I was, you know, in management at Best Buy, you know, years ago when digital TVs first came out. I mean, I remember there being a TV in there for $20,000. So, I mean, I think they're, you know, and I'm not going to say whether I think it's great or whatever. I played with it at SHOT Show, all that sort of thing. And I know there's two sides of that coin where some people say, you know, this isn't real shooting, blah, 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 this could fall in the wrong hands. But, you know, all that aside, you know, when things like this first come out, they're inherently expensive and only the rich can afford them. But as, you know, technology gets better and manufacturing gets cheaper, that'll come down. I mean, you see Remington, of course, it's not on the same caliber as Tracking Point, but they have one. You can buy that and whole rifle for like, what, $7,000? Or no, is it $4,000? So, yeah, I mean, right now it's inherently expensive, but it's gonna come down.
Well, I think it's just another publicity stunt, really, is what it is. We talked about the gun store owned by the gay black Republican in Texas a few episodes ago.
And... Wait, Hank Strange owns a gun store?
No.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
No. He's not a Republican, is he? No.
Hank, I don't know. Probably.
You guys are wrong.
Wait, he's in Florida. I'm sorry. Hank's in Florida, not Texas. That makes all the difference right there.
So, anyways, you know, it's probably just a publicity stunt, or at least partly, because, you know, Bitcoin is just so highly volatile. When we did that story on that gun dealer, I looked up the conversion for Bitcoin to U.S. dollars, and it was, I think it was 600 and some, 800 and some, somewhere around that range. And now it's down to 437, but while we were talking, it went up to 438.
Well, that's what kind of influence that we have. Much,
yeah, we're up here. That's how volatile this stupid thing is, you know, just in a couple seconds it goes up or down a dollar. I mean, that's crazy.
Yeah,
here, most gun guys don't trust the government or electronic currency. I don't want my currency electronic. You know, number one, there's personally, you know, the technology is supposed to be great and help us all, but it's the most unsecure thing there is. You know, and then number two, I thought it was fantastically funny that you say the gay Republican gun shop. And the first response from Jake isn't that he's gay. It says, is he a Republican? So I thought that was great. But yeah, I mean, I agree with you. I think this is all a publicity stunt. I mean, who's really using this
right.
at this point? Especially, you know, in this industry, who's using it as far as purchasers?
Right. At the bottom of this Truth About Guns article, by the way, all articles are in the show notes. It'll be at thisweekinguns.com/065 for this week. The last paragraph in the story, it says, in the grand scheme of things, it's really not a big deal. Trading goods and services is the basis of all business, no matter the currency. But because it's the new and shiny Bitcoin that you can, oh my God, buy guns with, it'll be the grab... You know, it'll grab some headlines like this one. But, you know, that's a good point. Guns seem to be one of the more frequently bartered items in the marketplace, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, it's more bartered than, like, tool, you know, power tools, stuff like that. You know, guns, you know, it seemed like inherently, for some reason, it's something that is much more bartered.
And it always has been. I mean, if you look back, like even in movies and stuff like that.
Right. My dad tells a story about how he traded a truck for a shotgun or
exactly.
the other way around. I don't
remember. And I have relatives the same way. I mean, I think guns have always been, well, I mean, if you look back history-wise, you know, like earlier, a gun was, I mean, how important? I know, you know, a lot of, you know, Americans take it for granted now, but, you know, back in the day, a gun was the grocery store. A gun was protection. You know what I mean? A gun was also entertainment as far as going out and having fun. I mean, I couldn't tell you how many times my dad, my uncles talk about, you know, going out and shooting 22s and just having a great time. And it didn't cost anything. But yeah, a lot of, you know, it's been bartered for years. And like I said, it fed families and protected families and all that. So why wouldn't it be, you know?
Right. So SIG 556 and P320, there's an update on guns.com. They're in production, and they are also shipping. So the, you know, SIG 556XI, it's pretty much just an updated version of the SIG 556 rifle. A little bit different stock and stuff, it looks like. But And it's also going to be available in 7.62, 300 AAC blackout, stuff like that. So not anything hugely revolutionary there, but they're releasing the P320, which is kind of the big, I don't know, kind of the big brother to or cousin to the P250, which, you know, the P250 is a modular SIG that has... the frame that you can kind of build a gun around. What do they call that? The FFL item of the SIG.
Yeah.
250.
The registered item. I don't remember what they call it, but it's basically just
the fire control unit.
Yeah.
FCU. So you can, you know, put different grips, grip frames, slides, barrels. So it's, they're trying to make it completely modular. Now the, you know, there were some issues with the first generation of those, and now the new this other version, the P320, is going to have a different trigger, different action. It's going to be striker fired. So the hopes are that this will be a much better version of their what they had, you know, conceived there for the P250.
Yeah. If it's like what I handled at SHOT Show, it is. That thing was, I was impressed with it. I look forward.
Were they at range day at SHOT Show?
Yes. The pistol was, I believe.
Okay. Yeah, I totally missed the booth and range day for these. So,
unless I'm wrong, I'm almost positive.
What, Aaron?
I said, good job, Jake.
I know.
Dropping the ball. Can SIG do wrong, though? I mean, has SIG ever come up with anything and everyone's like, man, that really sucked?
P250.
Yeah. Yeah, right. There are some people that are not very happy with the P250.
So. Yeah, everybody's had their issues, but and actually the P250 is really not a bad gun, at all really. But man, the trigger and everything on this gun is really nice.
That's what I'm hearing is that the trigger is going to be a big upgrade from what you saw in the P250. So.
Yeah.
I love the concept. I'm not sure that it always translates well into handguns, but the whole modularity of your firearm, it goes to the AR-15. That platform has become the completely modular platform.
Engineering is just advanced, with this kind of allowing tolerances and to be able to swap things out. And it also benefits the companies because suddenly you're not just selling one gun, but you're selling a gun and a lot of products that go along with it.
You know what they need to do? I don't know if they've gone this route yet, but because you can switch out the grip frame, which is just basically a piece of plastic, I guess, that slides in to the fire control unit. Well, they're doing it so you can have a full size and a compact with the same fire control unit, two different size grips.
Mm-hmm.
I think they're going about this all wrong. They need a pink one, a purple one.
You can bet they will.
I think they should have came off the bat with that, though. That would have been, if they would have came out swinging with the different rainbow of color options for this, I think that would have been huge.
I think we're going to see a lot more of this. It's really cool that, when you can have a subcompact, a compact, and a full size, really from buying one firearm. And you're going to get, the great thing about that is, to me, what I really liked about, you're going to get the same trigger. You're going to get the same break, the same feel, no matter what gun you have it in. And then, if you look at, the 250 that they have, and then you look at the new Pico, the little subcompact that Bretta's coming out with, it's kind of the same deal. You can change those frames and all that. I mean, I think this is something we're going to see more of.
Absolutely. I agree.
So, Chicago police arrest concealed carry permit holder. This 54-year-old Northwest Side man allegedly pulled a gun during a property dispute. Well, who doesn't?
Right. Right? I have a gun. I pull a gun right now. I would. Don't stop me. I'll be back.
It's Chicago. Everyone pulls a gun, right? I mean, that's how we solve things, right?
No one has one, but they all pull them somehow.
Right. Exactly. So, in a way, this is kind of unfortunate. Illinois is such a virgin when it comes to concealed carry licenses, and now we have this doofus running around with one.
Well, there's always going to be a first for everything. So right. This guy's, the only reason he's in the news is because he's the first CCW guy to get popped and lose it.
He's going to be that guy.
Everybody's
going to be like, thanks, Bob.
Right. Well, set it up, knock it down, here I go. Boom. Oh, thanks, man. Yeah, it is, if you're going to try to pistol whip somebody, don't use a 38, use something bigger. That's all I'm saying.
Right, and his woman hit it for him?
Right.
A woman both identified him who admitted hiding his gun.
An abandoned apartment.
Yeah.
This story can't get any better.
Right. The only thing that really shocked me about the story is it was an apartment, not a trailer.
Well, that's Chicago.
Yeah,
if it were in Michigan, it would have been two double. Well, double wide maybe, and a single wide.
Right, exactly. Double wide would have been like living the rich life.
So, Bolingbrook concealed. This is Illinois again. Bolingbrook concealed carry firearms instructor has been decertified because he's been issuing permits without properly training his students, which results in more than 300 students having their applications denied.
Oops.
And that's got to suck.
That's been happening here a lot. I am a CCW instructor here, and they've been really cracking down for about the last 6 to 8 months here, and it just happened in my county to another instructor, and another instructor that I know of was investigated. Because that, you know, that's happening a lot now. They're either, they're getting their money, they're not giving people the proper training. The guy that got busted here the last couple months ago wasn't even putting them through a shooting course whatsoever. We had one guy get busted shooting his garage. I mean, you know, it's just like anything else. You're going to get guys that are trying to beat the system and that are lazy, that don't want to do what's required right. for them to do.
Right. It drives me crazy. You hear of FFL holders trying to skirt, you know, doing certain things too, and it drives me crazy because we are under such a microscope in the firearms industry. We can't afford to do this. You know, we can't afford to be lazy. We can't afford to.
I'm pretty lazy.
Not only that, but you know, being a CCW instructor, I take that very seriously. Just like I do, you know. That's one of the reasons, like when you asked me earlier, you know, what my channel is about. That's one of the reasons I do that. I take, you know, I think honesty, like in doing that thing, is very important, because someone's going to, you know, use that gun possibly to defend their life at some point. And if I tell them it's a great gun, it ends up not working for them. You know, did I do my justice? So I think, you know, that's the sad part. We're under that microscope. And, you know, I think a lot of people just don't take that job seriously. It's more of a... you know, let me get paid. But I take it very serious. I mean, you're helping someone defend their life. So, and let's be clear, in most states, anyway, the training they get isn't training. I actually wrote an article about this. You know, CCW permits is licensing. It's not training. So, and not to say that you have to be trained, but you know. You get a lot of people, like I've had people in my classes that have never touched a firearm until that day. So I, you know, just do your due justice and take it seriously, and you know, try to make it a better community and not a a worse community.
Right. So. Absolutely. So Guam is trying to go to a shall issue territory. They're not state.
Yeah, they're a territory.
So a month after adopting a castle doctrine, this is on guns.com, and this is a little bit after federal court ruling may issue in the neighboring Hawaii, and now there's a bill in the Guam Senate that is pushing the territory to a shall issue, which is another win for us.
Guam, come on.
It's Guam.
Guam
should be able to protect themselves.
Right. Well, yeah.
What do you call them? Are they Guamians?
I thought they were Guamarians.
But yeah, I mean, absolutely. It's another win for us. I mean, and we need to keep knocking them down. Bam, bam, bam. But yeah, absolutely. I think it's great.
Yeah. Yeah. Castle Doctrine's huge. I always appreciate just the fact that we have that here in Michigan.
Yeah,
you know how many bodies I have to drag in my house just to prove a point?
But, and it's so easy there.
Right, exactly. It's just like, hey, yo, come here. You know, it's like always a homeless guy wandering around somewhere. But it's the shall issue Guam. I think that's great, but because it's Guam, it's so off the radar for your, you know, you're not going to see it on any other.
Well, not anymore.
Well, may. Even
well,
though,
sorry, go ahead. Sorry,
he just got
though,
it.
You know, they're U.S. territory, but maybe this will help. Prove an example for some other island nations around the world. You know,
like Puerto Rico. I don't know.
St. George. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know either. I don't know all the islands.
I haven't been on a cruise this year, so I don't know.
I've never been on a cruise, so I have no clue.
I always wanted to go on one, but everyone always gets sick, really.
I've never been either. So.
Oh,
you said this year. I thought.
I know. Like I'm living vicariously through you. And
I haven't been on a cruise this year or any other year, but
it's like you just gave me a puppy and took it away. Yeah. Dick.
So Yankee Marshall, the YouTube Yankee Marshall, has a video out, and he's saying our guns. Dangerous for the entry and citizen, or he's kind of posing that question of, because I think, I don't know, did you guys watch the video?
I did, yeah.
So I think he made this because there's a lot of instructors and or just people on the internet that basically drive people towards that, you know, if you're buying a firearm, you have to get training. You have to get training. You have to get training, and how that scares potential gun owners away, possibly.
Yeah.
You know, I was in a store the other day. It was like two in the morning. Just went in there to get a pack of cigarettes, and it was in a rough part of town. And a bunch of people came in that I did not feel comfortable around. At the time, I was open carrying, and you know, and I had to think. I thought to myself, you know, if something happens. Because you need to always be aware of your situation. If something happens, you know, I practice, I train, how would I handle the situation? You know, it's because it's you know, a lot of times, you know, people say I'm buying a gun, I'll protect myself, and they, in their mind, the situation is a single attacker, you know, not, but it's usually, you know, if someone's going to come after you, it's usually one or more people, you know, and training is important. You should train. I think the Yankee Marshall is wrong on this point. It's, you know, you should train. I'm sorry if it scares you away, but you're owning a firearm, and a firearm is a pretty deadly thing. You should know how to use it. You should know how to clean it. You should know, and you should know how well you can fire it, and on target. You should practice, and when I say practice, that's training right there.
Well, I don't agree with Yankee Marshall on a lot of things, but actually, to my surprise. I sort of agree. I guess what it is, you know, do you have to have training in order to be a safe gun owner? No, I don't believe you do either. I think a lot of it is common sense. But if you're a gun owner and you want to be more proficient, you want to be safer, and you want to really know how to use that gun, then absolutely you should. One of the, you know, going right back to one of the points that I just talked about in my CCW class is I'll say, look, now that you can carry that gun, learn how to use it. Come back and see me and learn how to use it. But I don't know that when I watched the video, I kind of got the impression that he was saying, look, for home protection, or just being in the home, will they be safe with it and not shoot themselves in the face? I think that is a common sense thing. But going back to what I said earlier is, you know, I've had people come to class that have never touched a firearm. And in that case, I think he is wrong. I think it is a common sense thing, but it's not a common sense thing when you go to break that gun down for the first time, when you, you know, when you go to break that Glock down for the first time and you shoot yourself in the hand. So I understand where he's coming from, but yeah, I do believe he's wrong in this instance. I think you absolutely should seek out some training, and I think if you're going to be a responsible gun owner, you will want to do that. And, you know, a lot of people are saying, well, yeah, of course you're going to say that because you want to train them. Well, that's not true. I don't care where you get training, but you should have some sort of training, whether... You know, it being safety. Look, it's just like driving a car. You know, you don't stick a 16-year-old kid in a car that's never touched it in his life and say, hey, take it easy.
Right.
Yeah. You know, you shouldn't do that with a firearm. But I understand where he's coming from. What he's saying is, you know, people in general are an intelligent being, and people buy guns every day and they're not shooting themselves in the face. That doesn't make them safe because they're not shooting themselves, because they're smart enough not to shoot themselves in the face. But exactly what you're talking about. What do you do when four people kick in your door? You have no training. Well, sure, you're smart enough to point it in the right direction and shoot, but if you've never trained under stress and you've never even shot the gun, I mean, how effective are you going to be?
You know, my mom has a firearm. She has a revolver because she didn't want to have to worry about a magazine and all that jazz. So she got herself a nice little revolver. She never shot the thing. Never. She's never shot it. She hands it. I mean, my mom is responsible. She grew up shooting with my grandfather, but that was, you know, like 1,000 years ago because she's really old. But, you know, the fact is she bought a firearm, never used it. I mean, I'm sure she knows how to use it, but she's not proficient with it. And that's the thing. Training makes you proficient. If you don't use it, you lose it in the sense of your abilities and your skills.
Yeah, that's what I was saying where I sort of agree. She hasn't shot herself with it.
Right.
So, yeah, she's intelligent enough not to be semi-safe. But, yeah, it goes back to, you know, look, if you're a responsible gun owner, you want to learn how to use it, and you should. So, you know, and I don't agree with him a lot.
Right, we should, but not everyone is going to.
Well, not everyone is, you know.
Not everyone's going to get raped either, but, you know, you should.
Right, that's exactly it. And, you know, I'll go back to saying something that, you know, a lot of people disagree with is James Jaeger. And I actually like James myself. I mean, we don't agree on a lot of subjects. But, you know, look, people say, well, I can't afford to go train. It's going to cost this much for ammo and it's going to cost this much for training. But you have 14 guns.
Right, yeah.
You know, I'm an advocate of training. And I do believe you can do a lot of training on your own.
You can dry fire, you can...
There's tons of stuff you can do, but...
You know, one thing
Let's talk about... I mean, I agree. Like, the gun guy with a safe full of guns, he probably doesn't have much of an excuse not to have some kind of training. But, you know, let's talk about, you know, people like your mom, Aaron. Or, like, you know, we hear of all these self-defense situations with little old ladies that had this revolver. Their husband died 20, 30 years ago. They haven't shot this revolver in 40 years. And they defend themselves. You know, that gun keeps them alive. So if you know, someone would have told that old lady, no, you don't get a gun unless you're going to get training, well, she would have never bought that gun probably.
Yeah, that's where I come back to where I sort of agree with him. You know, I can see both sides of that coin. But in a lot of those instances, like you just talked about, even recently, how many times is it that someone broke in the house and they fired a whole magazine or a whole cylinder and never hit anything? And, you know, it goes back to that point. Now, if that little old lady had a little bit of training and felt a little more comfortable handling that firearm, you know, what would have been the outcome? So, yeah, and there are instances, too, like, you know, these people that have $100 firearms that really don't have the money but need a weapon to protect themselves. I do understand that there are some people out here that cannot afford training. I do understand that part. And, you know, maybe seek out a friend that has more experience than you or anything. But I do believe professional training is nothing but a good thing. And this is the thing about our industry. You know, I mean, I have a YouTube channel. I get commandos every day telling me what I'm doing wrong, blah, 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 that have never probably touched a firearm. We all have opinions, and, you know, that's his. I do tend to disagree, but I understand what he's saying. You know, like the little lady, she's got enough sense not to play with this gun and shoot herself, and if this, someone comes in the house, she can blast off some rounds. But, you know, yeah.
Another problem with the Yankee Marshal is he just spends so much time yelling that it just becomes white noise after a while. You know?
Yeah.
He like makes a video every 40 minutes, so it's hard to keep up with them in the first
place. Yeah, a lot of things I disagree with Yankee Marshal on, but I don't, you know, we won't get into that.
Well, thanks. I was just going to launch my series of gun guy yelling on YouTube.
I'm in.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, who knows, guys? I mean,
okay. Look at it this way. If you go, let's stop this for a second, but we'll touch back on it in a couple of stories. How about that?
Okay.
Sure. Well, so, if you go here, like right there.
We're to the, yeah, we'll hit that one next. So we're to the maybe section. Beware of your target. No, really, be aware of your target. So, you know, the four rules of gun safety, be aware of your target, what's behind it, you know, blah, blah, blah. Well, apparently, you really need to be aware of your target because there is a man that was killed. That's right, he was killed by a ricochet off a steel target. I clicked into this story. I think this actually happened. This is on the Truth About Guns, but I think this happened it just happened a few weeks ago. So a 23-year-old man died March 19th after what's being investigated as an accidental shooting. Now, there's really not much on it, but he had a gunshot wound to the chest, and from what they can figure out is it ricocheted off a steel target that he was shooting in his backyard.
Yeah, I really want to know how close he was to that target.
Yeah, that kind of freaks me out because I shoot steel all the time.
Yeah,
it's my favorite thing to shoot.
You know,
you should normally either, you know, absorb it or drop it straight down. It shouldn't throw it back at you.
There's a lot of variables here. Was he shooting the right steel? Was the steel at the right angle? Was he shooting? What kind of ammunition was he shooting? How close was he? That's, you know, that's all a lot of things that we need to know.
I know. My dad is a welder, and he fabricates stuff. He actually, now that he's retired, he fabricates metal sculptures and stuff. So he's always got the scrap metal. And so he's like, oh, I can make a steel target out of that. I'm like, no, it's not. Not the right kind of steel, Dad.
Exactly.
Like, he's got stuff that he's like, look, I made this target, and it's like curved out at you. I'm like, no, no, please stop.
Well, you know, my father-in-law, he uses the steel you find on railroad tracks, those plates.
Mm.
You know, yeah. and the thing about those is when you hit those, they're so soft, and you know, most of your rounds either like sink right into it or go through it.
Did you guys watch the video here?
I did not. I don't watch videos. I don't believe in videos. Are we on video right now? Because I don't believe it.
Describe it. What's going on?
The video where the guy's shooting there on the page in the video and the tree falls.
Yeah, I just played it.
That happened to us just about a month ago.
Really?
Oh, maybe not that. Yeah. What it was is... We were actually at my dad's house, and I was shooting a video. And surprisingly enough, we were doing a couple of, you know, review videos and stuff like that, but I was doing the shootout challenge for We Like Shooting. And I was shooting my Chris Vector. And where I had what we did is we had like a 3/4-inch piece of plywood, and it was butt up against this like old stump, and there was a tree behind this stump. And I'm, pop, 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 you know, taking shots and, you know, probably shot 100 rounds of 45 ACP. And my wife was there that day and she was filming. And the next thing I know, my dad's like, look out. And this tree comes down, man. And it actually hit the camera and the limbs, just the small ones hit my wife. Oh, and then, you know, I really hurt myself. I was like, did it get the camera? So this is the wrong thing to say. But, yeah. You should. I mean, be careful, obviously. So, yeah, there's a lot of variables about, you know, this particular article that I would like to know, you know, the type of steel and the ammo he was shooting, how close he was. But, yeah, it's bad all the way around.
He was probably shooting that RIP ammo.
Well, right, I mean, because, you know, if you're shooting, like, a jacketed rifle round, maybe even a pistol round, and if you're shooting soft steel, the solid part of the bullet goes through the steel, and the jacket peels off and bounces back at you.
Right.
Something like that could have happened, or the steel could have been, you know, like you said, angled in the wrong direction. He could have been too close. It's really hard to say.
And that's a lot of things that are, you know, I think a lot of people see things in videos and stuff, and they go like, "Hey, I'm going to do that," whatever, and they don't try to seek out the information of, hey, is this steel okay to shoot? Does it need to be angled? You know what I mean? Who knows? It's so, like, you know, might have picked up a scrap piece of steel like Aaron was saying there. Who knows?
Yeah. So Milford man accidentally shoots his friend with a new gun. So is this what you're talking about with taking down a new Glock?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, my point was with the Yankee Marshal was the story.
You know? It's both. Yeah, that's it.
I mean, the guy, new gun, untrained, I guess. I'm hoping he's untrained if he shot his friend in the thigh.
Well, he was 21 years old. He was cleaning his new 40 caliber handgun, which, unbeknownst to him, had a round still in the chamber.
Which is one of the rules of gun safety. Always, your gun's always loaded.
Yeah, but that's a rule of gun safety, and that's usually something that you're taught.
Exactly. You learn when you get trained.
Right. So the gun discharged and, well, no, he pulled the trigger on the gun exactly. And discharged. And striking his friend in the upper thigh and exiting through his right buttocks.
Oh, that would suck.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So they were saying it appears to be accidental.
Now he's got two holes back there.
The police still confiscated his gun.
They should have taken his gun and hit him with it. You idiot.
They should have taken him and his gun and dropped him off at Yankee Marshals and say, hey, see?
There you go. I mean, first, all right, when I go to clean my guns, the first thing I do, drop the mag, pull, you know, charge it, make sure that it's empty, and then I take it apart. I don't pull any triggers.
Yeah, you charge it. You make sure it's empty by looking in the chamber and even feeling your finger in the chamber because crazy things happen. I mean, you can rack the slide, you can pull the bolt back and have a round still stay in the chamber.
Totally. Yeah. I mean, well, lesson learned, huh?
The last CCW class I taught, one of the guys at the class, him and his girlfriend took it. He actually shot himself with the gun that he took the class with.
After or before?
Not at the class, right?
Before.
Okay, good.
And it was a Glock. And, you know, like, for instance, a lot of people are like, oh, man, I can't stand that. You got to pull the trigger on a Glock. This doesn't bother me at all. And, like, the M&Ps, you know, you can reach down in there and hit that little disconnector so you don't have to pull the trigger. I don't never do that. I pull the trigger and slide the slide off. Look, it's and that's not to say, look, anybody can have an accident. It's just, it's human. You know, there's people out there, once again, I ain't going to say no names, but they say, I'm never going to have an accident. But don't
Yankee Marshall.
Don't right. say that. Anyone can have an accident. You just can't, you know, don't be complacent. I mean, you got to, safety is one of those things you need to keep focus.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah. So, off-duty Chicago cops shoots burglar who appeared to have a gun in his hand. But it turned out he didn't. But so
Chicago?
In Chicago?
They're not allowed to have guns, so he shouldn't have shot anyone.
That's right. So these thugs, they're trying
to
break...
Wait, how do you know they were thugs? They could have been, like, beanpole people.
Okay. Anyways.
That's conjecture, Your Honor.
This cop, he was, you know, on his day off or whatever, he was home with his baby? Like, daughter?
Son.
Son.
Child. We'll just say child.
Well, child. Baby could be a son.
Anyways, it heard that, you know, something going on at the front door, checked it out, and it looked like someone was trying to push in the door, so he told his child to hide in the bedroom, and he called 911. But in the meanwhile, he walked outside the house, out the back door, and walked around to the front door. And that's when he confronted the gentleman that were trying to push in the front door. And he said he saw something in one of their hands and shot them. The crazy thing about this story to me is, why would you ever leave your child in the house alone, exit the house, and go engage these guys?
Yeah, I'm guilty. I don't have any children. And if I did, I wouldn't leave the house. But, yeah, I've been guilty of going outside the home. And I know, you know, a lot of people are going to say, no, don't do that. But I've left look, I'll go into this. I almost shot the meter guy one time. Well, I shouldn't say almost shot him. That's not true, but.
You mean the meter thug?
Yeah. Well, I mean, look, man, it was like we had two instances in this house that we used to live in. It wasn't the greatest neighborhood, but it wasn't, you know, what you would consider really bad neighborhood, like where Aaron lives.
Right, exactly.
Or where I lived. But anyways, you know, we were up really early one time. I guess it was like, you know, 5. It was still dark. And the wife sees someone, like, she was like, somebody was looking in the window.
Yeah.
I was like, all right. I was like, you know, go to the bedroom. Bam. I go outside. And I have my gun, but, you know, I'm not drawn on the guy. And it's the metered guy. And I'm like, you know, wow. This is kind of, you know, number one, why were you in my window? You know, when he would, maybe he didn't know where the meter was, understandable, blah, blah, blah. But anyways, it wasn't that big a deal. Now, the one time that was a big deal is there was a storage building behind the house, or, you know, those storage facilities. And there was these people living in one of them. It was pretty smart. They rented a storage building. It's cheap. And it has a light in it. So they took the light bulb out and put one of those sockets in that have plugs.
Yeah.
So they're using the electricity. They have heat. They've got a couch, a TV. And
flats right there.
Yeah. One night, that guy, it was a man and a woman. He was coming through the yard there and drunk, stumbled into the house. And I went out that time as well. And, you know, is that a mistake? I don't know. Going outside, leaving, probably is. I should have stayed inside. But, yeah, I would never leave my kid inside, though. Like, hey, hold down the fort. I'll be right back.
Here's your own gun. I'll be right back.
Yeah.
Well, you know, this in regards to the story, there was a lot of things that were just seemed kind of odd. You know, A, he said the guy had a gun. B, he went out to, you know, challenge him. C, he said the guy drew on him, but yet the guy was shot in the back. You know, there's some fishy parts of the story. I luckily have never had an issue where someone's tried to enter my home, or they're lucky they've never tried to enter my home, because I would be like, Castle doctrine. But yeah, you know what? You're gonna have to erase that, because if you know when that happens, they're gonna be like, look, you wanted that to happen.
No, too late. It's a live show.
I'm just gonna start swearing then, and you're gonna have to edit everything. No, but seriously, it's like you know. Do you leave your kid inside? He's a police officer. I think he sent him to the bedroom. He had 911 on the phone. I think the child probably was safe. He did see the people, you know, he saw his door frame buckling, starting to buckle when they were pushing on the door, you know, trying to get in. You know, I personally would have just put a couple rounds through the door myself. That would have pushed them off a little bit. But
okay, you know. We do not condone self-defense advice by Aaron or shooting through doors.
Yeah,
or
exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, going outside is probably not the right answer. I mean, I've been guilty of it. I probably wouldn't do that now, but...
Now?
But, I mean, yeah.
Right meow? Meow?
There's a lot of questions with that story, too. Who knows? I mean...
You know, the problem is there's so many, you know, if it was a civilian... it would be looked over with a fine-tooth comb. Because it's a police officer, it'll probably be a larger brush.
And it should be less looked over if it was a civilian, in my thinking, because this guy's well-trained. Well, he should be. He should be trained in a shoot-or-no-shoot situation, whereas, you know, like a lot of civilians that are untrained, they're not. So, if it were... Well, number one, cops are civilians, so let's get off that. But he's a police officer, so he does have training. So, to me, if it were a civilian that has absolutely no training that shot someone that he thought had a gun, I would think that would be, you know, less scrutinized than it would with someone that was trained to be in that situation.
I see, trained. Yankee Marshall, you're wrong again. Training.
Well, I love the irony here. I mean, they break into a cop's house. I mean,
yeah.
Well, the good news is he didn't kill him. I mean, it just proves it's a cop because he's a terrible shot.
Okay, you can send your hate mail to Aaron at This Week in Guns.
Well, you know, like New York cops, they shoot at somebody and they end up hitting like 16 other people in the process of trying to get one person. Let's all be honest here.
Yeah. Can't say it didn't happen.
And then the people that get hit are in trouble because they're in the wrong spot.
Right. Or there was one story where a police officer shot at a guy, hit somebody else, and killed him. And then charged the guy with murder because, even though he was unarmed, charged him with murder because it was his fault that the officer drew the gun and fired.
Yeah, it was an act of a crime.
Yes.
All right. Well, Brownells helps make this show possible. The leading supplier of firearms, accessories, gun parts, and gunsmith and tools. You can find it all at Brownells. Please visit thisweekinguns.com/Brownells. And you can now contribute to Firearms Radio Network and This Week in Guns by shopping at Amazon. That's right. You already shop at Amazon. I know you do. So if you simply click one of the Amazon banners on Firearms Radio Network or thisweekinguns.com or bookmark firearmsradio.tv/Amazon, a small percentage will help out the show. So we are to the pick of the week. This is a segment where we pick a product to highlight. Could be anything. Anything. So, Aaron?
Good or bad?
Yeah, good or bad. Aaron, what do you have?
For this week, I don't have a what, but I have a where. And look at that. Spelled it correctly there. This over the weekend, I went down to Thunder Valley Precision in Ohio. And it was pretty cool. It was they have it's a long range shooting competitions down there constantly. I was there for the Intimidator courses.
You were there with Jeremy.
Jeremy and Lil from We Like Shooting. I was just there filming. I did not bring a rifle.
Yes. Tell me this: did Lil survive that whole time with you and Jeremy without, like, throat punching either of you?
But here's the thing. I'm a perfect gentleman in real life.
I have a theory. If you watch the video that, of course, Aaron put up, she's wearing, like, 8 shirts and, like, 14 pairs of pants. It wasn't even cold there.
It was a barrier.
You know, I watched the show, the We Like Shooting show the other night, and I heard...
Yeah, and she burned all those layers after she got home.
Yeah. And what's the first thing that Jeremy says? He's like, yeah, I was poking her.
Right, yeah.
I'm like, really? You see her and you start poking at her?
Seriously, it was funny. But yeah, I mean, it was cold there. And she made a great shot at 1,048 yards. First shot hit some steel.
It wasn't 10,000?
Yeah, I said 10,000. I meant on the show, but it was 1,000. The place is sprawling. It's amazing. It's 350 acres. And the guy also makes precision rifles there. So it's pretty sweet. And I think, if I understand correctly, he's actually a world record holder for hitting the guy who owns the place. I want to say he hit a target at 1,500 yards in a 3-inch group. Three shots. Maybe it was a 1.5-inch group. But, I mean, it was just a spectacular shot at distance. So yeah, and you can find them at thundervalleyprecision.com. You should check out the website. Check out they're on Facebook, and it's if you ever get a chance to go to Ohio, but first before you go, you need to watch the video to understand how to get there, because it plays a very important part of the whole story of Thunder Valley.
Very cool, Darrell. Do you have a pick of the week?
Yeah, I'm gonna talk about the Remington R51, which has been the big thing here lately for me. I was really excited about that gun. I don't know if you looked at it at SHOT Show, but before I went, really excited about that gun. I liked the Pedersen action. I thought it was cool, it's unique, and it looked pretty cool, and a lot of people hate the looks of it. And, you know, really excited about that. So when we went out there, media day on the range, I'm looking for it. And to my surprise, there's not one to be found. So, you know, just talking to other reviewers right then and there, kind of speculation to what's wrong, you know. So, you know, after media day on the range, first day of SHOT, I find Remington booth, put my hands on it, And I just wasn't impressed. A lot of things that I felt quality-wise that just weren't right to me. And talked to the rep, questioned some of the things, got some answers that really, you know, didn't make any sense for me. So, you know, I kind of was like, okay, maybe it wasn't ready for prime time, and maybe that's why, you know, they want to do a little work before they release and let reviewers shoot it. So I was okay with that. Well, as soon as it was available, I have a dealer that I always call as soon as I find out about something and say, when this is available, call me. They're a big dealer. They're able to have a lot of buying power, so I'm usually able to get stuff. So they did, and I got a hold of it, and to my amazement, it is the, I'm not really hard on Remington. I like Remington. I've had stuff for years, but it is probably the worst put-together handgun I've ever put in my hands at that particular moment, at least that particular gun. And problems consisting of firing out a battery, trigger, trigger wiggle, just a ton of different stuff. So I did several reviews on that. And it is, I've mailed it off to Remington today. So I am waiting for it to get back, and hopefully that it will be right at that point.
Well, hopefully they'll just send you back a Glock.
Well, I'm hoping it does come. I mean, I want it to work. You know, I got a lot of, I think I was one of the first people to put out negative comments about that gun, and it wasn't comments. I showed it everything that happened with that gun. The slide seized, closed after about 100 rounds on the first day. I had to come home and soak it in lubricant in order to free it. And
oh, yeah.
Had a couple other seizures the next time.
Like physical seizures or with the gun?
Yeah, I was able to get under 400 rounds in the gun due to the gun. And then firing out a battery, primer bulges on overpressure, just too many. And then once I tore that down, within, you know, under 400 rounds, there's gouging in the rails of the aluminum frame.
Really? That's terrible.
Some of the pins had actually started to work their way out of the gun.
And we can see all this in your video?
Yes, there's three or four videos on that gun.
And that's on at YouTube/ Tacticals Existence?
That's it.
But yeah, I linked to the first one here, and then you can follow through to the rest.
And I'll do an update when it does return. But now, since I did post that, I see a lot, if you just read the comments on those videos, but lots of other people are actually, you know, posting that their guns are having the same issues. I mean, I got a lot of hate when I first put that up, you know. But even, you know, Mac has put one up showing drifting the sights out of the gun with his finger on a brand new one. The slide would actually hold open on the gun, brand new with no magazine in the gun. So, but surprisingly, there is some good. Somebody asked me today, is there any good in this? There is. The gun's accurate. One. And then, other than that, I actually like the sight picture in the gun, and,
it's just all a break-in period.
Well, I don't know about that. there's some good to it. Accuracy was really good with it. And then, I actually like the sightline. I like the design, but, I just want it to work. You know, the reason why I wanted to actually post this was, you know, that's touted as a CCW gun. So once again, like I was saying, someone's going to use that to carry. So, it should be the best that it can be.
Absolutely. So my pick of the week is the Arms Corps, or the Rock Island Armory, 22 TCM 1911. Did you get a chance to shoot this at SHOT, Darrell?
I didn't shoot it. I wanted to shoot it, but I didn't get a chance to.
It's pretty crazy. It's a custom round. It's a bottleneck pistol caliber cartridge. It's traveling at over 2,000 feet per second, but it really doesn't have any recoil. I mean, it's really tamer than like a 9 mil.
Yeah, but it's a cool looking round.
Yeah, it's a completely custom round that Rock Island Arms Corps developed, and it's looking really promising. I shot it. It's it was fun to shoot, and just, you know, a little bit hands-on time there at SHOT Show. The you know, fit and finish of these new Rock Island 1911s is excellent.
It's funny, the picture impressed. They're showing of it, though. Picture on the on their website of their handgun, because they changed all their roll marks now. It's not that huge honking Rock Island armory on the side. It's like a little one on the back.
Yeah, I like Rock Island armory.
Really, I'm sorry to steal your thunder here, Jake. My father-in-law just bought a 10mm from them and has had nothing but issues with it.
Really? Yeah, yeah. I shot the 10mm, the TAC version of the 10mm, and that was really awesome.
And well, all the tolerances were loose. The guide rail, ejection port were off kilter. I mean, it was
Send it back. Lifetime warranty.
Yeah, I think he did. And you know, it's just there's yeah. I mean, 10mm, 9mm, 45, Rock Island. You know, it's all 1911s to me.
Well, they are 1911s.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
That's because they are.
Look, yeah, anybody can have a lemon or a bad gun. So
made on a Friday.
Yeah, like, you know, had that R-51 been just that gun, that would be fine. You know, there's bad stuff. So yeah, I'm with Jake. Send it back and lifetime warranty.
Well, and you know what? You can send an email directly to the CEO Martin. Because I interviewed him on this week's Gun Guy Radio that releases a Sunday, and he gave out his personal email address for any issues. So there you go.
Sucker.
Straight to the top.
Oh, you know what? I'll definitely listen, because I would like that email, because I have so many issues with that thing. It looks nice. It's a good weight. I mean, it's 1911s are traditionally a heavier gun, and shooting 10mm was like shooting nothing out of there. You know, it's like shooting a 9 or a 22 out of that big. You know, it's a lot of steel there to absorb a lot of the shock of the shot. Mm-hmm. You know, but it just was not flowing right.
Yeah, they'll take care of it. You know, he even said, in the 90s, the Rock Island or Arms Corps stuff, it wasn't Rock Island there, then it was coming in as Charles Daly. And
isn't he your coach? Martin, in Chicago or something?
Martin, you know, in my interview, you'll hear him say, he's like, hey, I'm sorry for the 90s and 1911s. He says, send them in. He says, even those, we'll make it right, or we'll send you a new one. So,
cool. It's nice to see a company do that, though. You know, so many people don't want to say, oh, no, never been a problem. You know what I mean? So it's nice to see someone that say, hey, we know these weren't the greatest. So.
Yeah, he even said, you know, half the people liked their guns back then and half hated them. Well, he's like, that's because half of them were good and half were bad.
Exactly.
But yeah, so back to the TCM-22, the one I put in the pick of the week, it's pretty cool because it comes, it's a combo. It comes with a 9mm barrel. So you can shoot either round. And he, in my interview, he compared the TCM round to like the 5.7, the F&H 5.7. That's kind of the market they're going after. But this is a, you know, much more cost-effective pistol because it's, you know, 600-ish, I think, where the 5.7, you can't get into, you know, a pistol for it for under 1,000, really.
I'd really like to see the ammo stack. You know, their new 22 versus a standard 22. Because it looks like it's a lot more powder in there.
Yeah, it's just don't compare it to a 22 long rifle.
Yeah.
Compare it to like a 5.7 or something like that.
How easy will it be to get ammo for that? Just out of curiosity.
Well, you know, they're making it as fast as they can. You know, of course, ammo. The situation with that, and he said, I think Lee Hornady and they already have dyes out for it. And I think he said
RCB. Dylan, Okay.
And we'll have dies up by the end of the year or something like that. So, you know, the reloading manufacturers are already, you know, putting out equipment for this. So it seems like it may be a, you know, reliable new, not reliable, but a viable new round here where you can, you know, reload it, you can buy ammo for it. So I'm hopeful. But
and it, 22 it caliber, great. It'd be nice to be able to reload something like that.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, they'll be on Gun Guy Radio this Sunday. It's newest episode, so you'll check that out. Because he talks about how they developed it and everything. They're really interesting story of how that even came about. So that about wraps up the show. But first, let's find out what our panelists are up to. So, Darrell, what's going on at Tactical Existence?
It's really just same old stuff for us. I mean, we have tons of reviews.
Oh, not same old stuff. You have a big giveaway going on.
Well, yeah. I mean, just everyday stuff. But yeah, we got about a week left in the giveaway. Where we're giving away a brand new Glock 42. It's basically the ultimate CCW giveaway. It's everything that you could want or need for CCW. So for that person that doesn't have, you know, any gear, there's a Glock 42. Cook's holsters is supplying a holster, which will be, you know, built to your specs, what you're wanting. We're also giving away a wilderness instructor's belt. There's going to be a Kershaw Cryo assisted open knife, a Gerber Black Diesel multi-tool, and a Caltech flashlight, and a pair of Pneuma shooting glasses. So basically everything that you would want or need for the giveaway. And you can enter that giveaway at www.tacticalexistence.com.
Very cool. I did. I entered.
Yeah, I'm entering right now.
Yeah, it's there's about a week left, so hopefully everybody will get entered in, and good luck to everybody that does.
Yeah, Glock 42, man, that's new stuff.
Yeah, and you know we're doing a review on that since it's been out. I've had that since the day it's come out, and I'm actually carrying it right as we speak. So, and guess what? I'm carrying it in a Cook's holster. So. Yeah, it's awesome, awesome gun so far. We've had no issues with it.
Yeah, it's tiny. Well, not tiny, but it's smaller.
It is, you know, when they first announced this, you know, I'll be eating a little crow when review time comes around, because when they first announced that, you know, like everybody else, I was like, this should have been a 9, all that jazz. But as soon as I put my hands on it at Media Day on the range, I was there with Matt from the Bang Switch. And I just kind of looked at him and was like, yeah, I spoke too soon. It's really a pleasant gun to shoot and probably the softest and smoothest shooting 380 I've ever shot. Really like the 42. So, yeah, go over and enter. And like I said, good luck to everybody that enters. It's kind of like the lottery. You have to enter to win.
Right. Or, you know, like a prostitute.
No, you had to take us there.
Yeah, I mean, you had it. It was great, and then you run it at the end.
Aaron, besides your nightlife activity, what have you been up to? You like shooting?
We Like Shooting has been doing tons of stuff. You know, besides the reviews, we're kicking out videos. We will have a video review of the RIP ammo. I'm sure you've seen a lot of different. You've seen a lot of people shoot different things with the RIP ammo, usually meat or something. Wait till you see what our Savage 1R shoots with his RIP ammo. And also, we have our Patreon project, which is pretty cool. While Daryl's giving something away, we ask for a little support. We ask you to give something to us. You can go to welikeshooting.com/pledge. You know, you can give a nickel, a dime, a penny, a dollar, $1,000,000 if you're one of the Koch brothers and you're listening to the show. You know, it just helps support the show, helps support the network, it helps support everyone. It helps support my 16 kids. So yeah, be aware. Help us out.
How much do I have to pledge to get some, you know, maybe better hosts? on the show.
Well, you can kick people off if you pledge enough.
So, oh, we can vote people off the island?
You can. You can, for an episode, if you pledge enough money, you can have one of
no,
your...
No, an episode. I'm talking permanently. Come on.
Well, you know. Yeah. You know, if you donate that amount, like, times... I mean, it was four shows to four times 12, 145. I just made that number up. I didn't math it. But yeah, no, it's but we got lots. I mean, just the video, I posted the video of Lil, Jeremy, and I. And let's be honest, like, I'm like not the best diplomat for We Like Shooting. I'm not the best ambassador. The crew there are really good stand-up folks, and I just happen to be the one that got picked for tonight to be on the show.
Now, do you all accept Bitcoins?
yeah, because, I mean, that's a deal-breaker for me. If you don't accept Bitcoins...
That's all I use.
That's how you guys roll, huh? Bitcoins. Yeah, and you drive in your Teslas, right?
How do you know?
You bought it with Bitcoins.
I did, in fact.
No, you wouldn't know if I bought it with Bitcoins because they're untraceable.
That's right. Bit what?
Yeah.
Exactly.
Exactly. So, very cool. Yeah, well, or you can go to patreon.com/WeLikeShooting. We'll also get you there. And I am a patron of the We Like Shooting podcast.
You know, when we saw that you gave us money, we all thought it was just for pity. We were like, oh, he feels bad for us.
It was. Nailed it. All right, well, that about wraps up this show, so leave your feedback. Feedback, yes, we love your feedback at the bottom of this video or the bottom of the show notes at thisweekinguns.com/064. Please subscribe in iTunes if you're on the road, working out, whatever you're doing. You can listen to via podcast on thisweekinguns.com/iTunes. Please subscribe and give us a review. And don't forget, you can contribute. You can keep this show going by shopping at Brownells and Amazon, thisweekinguns.com/Brownells or firearmsradio.tv/Amazon. And that about wraps up the show for this week. I really appreciate you guys coming on. Thank you so much, Darrell.
Okay. Thanks for having me.
And we'll see you next week, Aaron. Or
yes.
Maybe. We'll see.
Yeah. If we have it depends on the feedback, I think.
Jake, just call me. I mean, yeah, I hate to
sorry.
Say this.
I said the wrong name. How embarrassing. I meant Darrell, not. Okay. Well, that's a wrap. We'll see you next week.